Happy Saturday morning and welcome to another episode of Collider Mailbag here from the Collider Studios worldwide here from Burbank, California. I'm your host, John Roca. I hope all you're getting ready to celebrate New Year's Eve and New Year's. We're doing the same thing here at the studio. We're pre-taping this episode so that you know you don't get a day without Collider content to enjoy your day. And who else, who better to bring on to the show to be a guest for us on this lovely Saturday morning than Wendy Lee. How are you?
Oh my gosh, what an introduction. Thank you so much. I am doing great. I'm finally getting over my cold.
Oh yeah.
It took me out for almost a week.
Yeah.
I don't ever get sick.
Ken Napsok, patient zero.
Was
killed,
he really?
He killed the whole office just coming in doing Jedi Council.
Oh.
He spread that Mandalorian flu on everybody and we barely survived. That's for damn sure. Even Adam went down for that thing.
No.
And Cody Hall was super
this
down.
This is
for
not
that
the
thing.
Way.
No, this is not the way.
Not the
that
way.
That is perfect. Hope you all enjoy the Mandalorian as well. That's a great point. We're going to answer questions from you all, the Collider fans here on this episode. You guys know how it works. And if you're new to the show, welcome aboard. We usually get questions from you, the fans. When we put the calls out on social media, on Twitter and on Instagram, if you put that hashtag Collider Mailbag, makes it easier for me to find. It's really difficult to find questions from you all if you don't put that on there because they get lost in the mix. The hashtag makes it easier to find on social media. And hey, if you don't want to do that, you can always email us at mailbag@collider.com. I pour through all those, pick out five questions, send them, I guess, and we're ready to go. Are you ready?
I am ready.
All right, let's jump into this thing. Our first question, it comes from Jeff Kutach. It's an email. I hope that's right, or Kutach. I want to get that right. Hello, Mr. Rocha, and super awesome guest. That's for very sure.
Hello.
Do you think the Oscars should increase the number of acting nominees categories from the regular five to say 7 or 8 or possibly 9? Or would that never be something they would consider to possibly make room for performances that could have been snubbed? Wendy.
I mean, I feel like every year more and more times, I feel like, of course you want to nominate as many people as yeah. possible, but I think that makes it harder for the actual voting process, the more people you have. So I think they do whittle it down there. So they have regular five, right,
mm-hmm.
right now?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it's because I'm so used to seeing five. For we've been watching the Oscars for a really long time, so yeah. five seems like a very normal number to me. I mm-hmm. think if you want to increase it to like a 7, that's not so bad. I think a 9 is a little much. Then we're okay. going to be there all night.
Right. Oh, that's a fair point.
Yeah.
Right?
But it is nice when you open it up to that bigger number mm-hmm. for more actors to be nominated. So they're actually acknowledged for their work. Because oftentimes when you have the five, it's that very small window. They yeah. can't all get in there and they can't all be nominated. You know, they kind of miss out by that one
yeah.
other person. Like that one other person beats no. It's kind of like, well, you know, their performance was excellent. I wish they were at least nominated.
Right, right. Well, the exclusivity of it all kind of goes away as you increase, right? The more people that are possible to be nominated, the exclusivity of it becomes a little less noteworthy. So to speak. But that being said, there is more and more content from these streaming services coming out. They're all essentially trying to become mini studios with original content, original movies. Certainly Netflix, Amazon Prime now doing this thing. Apple TV getting involved mm-hmm. as well. So many Hulu's doing this. There's so much original content that's coming down the pike that maybe replaces what the studios used to do. Some of these I call them like mid-major as yeah. as sports reference, mid-major kind of movies. Do those get put on those streaming services and do those performances get recognized? So I think we're looking at a future where we start to increase the number of nominees per category. I certainly feel the director nominees need to be pushed to at least
yes.
10 possible nominees because it's kind
yes.
of ridiculous that we kind of limit, we increase the best
too?
Picture. Yeah,
Good
we
God.
Increase best picture, but we limit the directors. That doesn't make sense to me at all. And Jeff Snyder, we were at the Insider last night for a screening. He mentioned to me, he said, what if we made the amount of directors correlative to the amount of best pictures? So you can have 10, but if only 8 best pictures are nominated, then 8 directors can get nominated, not just 5 and not a full 10.
I don't mind that. And yeah. I also think that's a really good point, what you're saying about streaming, because that's where we're seeing The Irishman, that's where we're seeing
right.
Marriage Story, Dolomite is my name. And so I wonder if instead, and I don't know if they'll do this, I don't know if I love the idea, but I'm just going to say it. but like, so we have, you know, best actor in feature film, motion picture. Mm. What if they do a best actor in a streaming service?
It's still going to add time.
It's still going to, it's always going to add
new category,
time.
Yeah.
yeah. So it's either you add that or you increase the number, you know, so there's a lot of places that I think the Academy can play around. But I think with the massive amount of content that yeah. we're getting now, we probably should increase that number to at least more than five.
Yeah, I feel like 10 years from now, the Oscars are going to look completely different.
Oh, yeah.
Right? I mean, all kinds of stuff happening here. All right, what's our next question, Wendy?
All right, the next one is also an email, and it comes from George Bates, who writes, "Hello, Mr. Rocha and guest. Hope you're having a nice day so far. Compared to years ago before YouTube and podcasts, there weren't as many film critics out there, as they were mainly limited to newspaper and film journalism. However, nowadays there are so many critics across social media and YouTube. Do you see this as an issue with so many critics? It's hard to tell who is a legitimate, well-informed critic who takes care in how they assess and analyze movies and who is greatly biased and less informed. Thanks for taking my question and take care." What a good question.
This is such a great question. You're absolutely right, George. Yeah. You know, if you have a camera, you can become a YouTube person who criticizes movies or analyzes movies. That's certainly possible. That's part of the advent of this social media and internet age. So, but I always go back to this. It is, how accredited is the film critic? Now, yes, you can find other film critics that are not in any organizations, and they may speak your language, and they may be someone you gravitate to and understand and go like, okay, if they like the movie, I'll like the movie. That's the old school way of finding a film critic that you like is, do they like a majority of the films that I like? Is their taste the same as mine? And can they really analyze and break down these movies? So I always go hunting for critics who have like a large following, because that tells me that they're moving past this idea of being credited by like Variety or Hollywood Reporter or even Collider. They have their own way of building it, and fans come and listen to their analysis because they trust their analysis. I think that's the number one thing to look at, is how many people are subscribed to their channels and how many videos do they have, and then just watch one video, and if you sense this person has a good understanding of film, then why not?
Yeah, and I also think a lot of it, it's like whether they're legitimate or not. It really depends on, because like in the olden days.
Yeah. 15 years ago, 20 years ago, in the olden days.
But when film criticism, film journalism was mainly in print.
Yes.
Newspaper, magazines, before the kind of the age of the internet. Before that, it was, you had to have a resume.
Yes.
That padded, you know, your like credibility and stuff like that. And now, kind of like you said, with social media, if you've got a camera or heck, a smartphone, which everybody has, you can go in your car and, you know, film a video. So I think it now really speaks to, if you're watching this person, one, do they speak your language?
Yeah.
Are they reviewing just one-off films every now and again? Then they're maybe not so into the films. They're not so serious. Do they? Is it a variety of different genres of films? It really depends on that person who is reviewing it, what film speaks to them, and what kind of language do you, us, as the audience, kind of understand their language.
Yeah.
So that's kind of how I, when I look for film reviews, I kind of look. But of course, number, kind of like you said, is another big factor for me.
Yeah.
And if I'm clicking for a review for, say, Cats, I come across two videos, one has 15 views, one has 100, I'm more likely to click on that 100 because, you know, more people seem to. And then afterwards, it's kind of like, if I don't agree, maybe I'll go back to that 15 view and be like, oh, I agree with them more, give them a little follow. So it just really depends.
Yeah, it does depend. It depends on your own personal taste. And, you know, back in the old days, in the olden days, there were so many newspapers, you just didn't know those critics were out there. The San Jose Mercury News or whatever there was out there, you didn't know. Rotten Tomatoes kind of accumulated, brought on all those reviews, so you could go to one place and take a look and read those reviews. I still go to that. I still always go to Rotten Tomatoes because they link to those reviews of a movie. And if you like the critic, you can read their full review. That's always still possible. But yes, it's up to you to do the hunting and searching, just like it was up to us back in the olden days, do the hunting and searching, finding those reviews, because not all of us subscribe to those magazines or those newspapers. So sometimes we'd have to go to the library and read them in the library or rent them out to read and return it. Those were those days back then. So
And another thing we have to remember when we watch a film reviewer or a film critic on social media, and even back then when they're just writing in newspapers and magazines, it's still, even though well informed and they're analyzing, this is their job, they've been doing it forever, it is still an opinion.
Yes.
Right? It's not like so-and-so loved Cats, therefore it is a good movie.
Right.
It just kind of, you have to gauge what it is for that person.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's also really important that it's not the end-all be-all when one critic shuts down a movie and the other one praises it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that's the thing at the end of the day. So do your own research, do your own exploration. You'll see it. Just click movie reviews and you'll see the accounts that come up and you'll see the number of subscribers. That's usually the way to go. And then from there, do your own hunting and searching. It's kind of how it works nowadays.
Yeah. Or you can just go with the big four.
The big four, THR and Variety and all of that. And even Collider.
Or Collider,
yeah. what's our next? Oh, I got our next question. It's from Stephen Vo from Twitter. He asks, Collider Mailbag, is the upcoming Dolittle being set up to fail? I'm questioning why Universal would give a big budget family tentpole film with a big cast a mid-January release date, only one trailer and minimal overall marketing so far. Wendy.
Well, it is in January, and right now I feel like, say what you will about movies that end in January, this has a huge star in it.
Yeah.
Robert Downey Jr., he's like, you at this point, everybody knows, you just say RDJ and everybody knows who he is, right? I feel like personally, the non-existent marketing, if you will, is because they know right now they're competing in the holiday season with these holiday movies that are out. Star Wars, it's a big one. So it's like, I feel like if they put it out right now, it's gonna get lost a little bit.
Yeah.
So I think as we get closer to the very first week of January, the more and more we're gonna see, you know, it's a fun family film. It's gonna be one of the ones that it's gonna kick off the next season for moviegoers. So I think it's just, we have yet to see it.
Yeah, it's all timing. And I think Wendy brings up an excellent point. It's about timing. I mean, this whole December is consumed by Jumanji and Star Wars. Mm-hmm. That you release anything, it's gonna get lost in the mix, even trailers.
Yep.
The Top Gun Maverick trailer for one day or a few hours was great. And then everyone was back to focusing on Star Wars, you know?
Yeah.
Same thing. And so with Dolittle, those trailers that got released didn't really get a lot of positive reactions.
Right.
So maybe they're like, you know what? We're just gonna hold off.
On it.
Yeah, and maybe they're working on it. Maybe it's gonna hold off until the calendar year turns, and then in January they'll start the promotional marketing and what have you to get people interested in it. And maybe they know they have a stinker of a movie, so they don't want to promote it too much, because the more you see of a stinker of a movie, the less curiosity you have in wanting to go see it. So they're playing this thing in a certain way, and maybe they drop the ball here, so they're just going to release it and see what happens and try to cater it towards kids. That you studios do that all the time. I think they did that with Charlie's Angels. I don't think the marketing was that smart. I don't think it was good. I don't think they understood what they had, and they didn't know how critics were going to react. It's not screening that thing until the possible last minute was a massive mistake overall, because they couldn't build up buzz through critics to get people to go into that theater and see it. So
It
goes both ways.
Yeah, I totally agree. And it's just kind of weird too. Like, and I don't feel like it's with movies that don't get any marketing.
Yeah.
It's not really limited to, maybe it used to be once upon a time limited to January, February time.
Right.
And I feel like now, because there was another movie, Nancy Drew, Sophie Lillis was in it. I saw the movie. It's fine. Like a teenage movie, teenage girl movie, super cute. She's excellent in it. They kind of buried it.
Yeah.
And I fully enjoyed the movie. I was like, all right, it's cute. It's a cute movie. So, and there were essentially no marketing from what I can remember. And then once it released, it was very quiet. I was like, whoa.
Yeah.
And I didn't think it was bad.
Yeah. See, you just never know what the combo is in that way. What's our next question, Wynn?
The next one also comes from Twitter, and this one comes from Matthew Shellman, who asks, hashtag Collider Mailbag, do you think a possible Jumanji 3 would try to get Dunst for a major role or a cameo?
I think that would be brilliant.
Oh,
you know,
my gosh.
It was announced recently that Elizabeth Shue is going to make an appearance in the third season of Cobra Kai. So why not bring Kirsten Dunst back? Kirsten Dunst, who's been killing it lately. She was great in Fargo. She was great in that new Southern film that's going, Southern series that's on Showtime. Mm. Getting a lot of accolades, you know. And she's one of these great actresses that kind of flies under the radar for people because, you know, she's caught up in that Spider-Man stuff, other things. She doesn't get a lot of high-profile roles. So why wouldn't she come back here and be part of this franchise, especially given the way the film ends? No spoilers, given the way the second one ends, or the third one, I should say, I guess,
if you include
the original Jumanji, it certainly is possible to have Kirsten Dunst come back into this one.
I know who you're talking about, but the name is not coming to mind.
I
know him.
Yeah.
You and I both know him.
We do.
Yeah.
He could be part of this thing as well. And so, and Bonnie Hunt is certainly a possibility as well. So there's David Alan Greer. All these things are possible, I think, but certainly getting Kirsten Dunst to do a cameo or a little bit more than a cameo would be fantastic on so many levels. Maybe she's Brittany's mom. The blonde girl, the blonde actress's mom.
Because we haven't seen her family. We haven't
seen her family. So maybe she's the mom of Brittany. That's certainly possible. And being involved in this Jumanji thing.
Or Martha.
Yeah, or Martha. Sure. Really. Either way.
Have we seen Martha's parents? I really can't remember. I don't think so. The movie, I feel like, really focuses on.
Yeah, Alex Wolff's character.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And his family. We've really seen his family, obviously. No, I would love this. And I know a lot of people have been screaming for wanting, you know, a cameo from one of the original cast members since the, what is that? Welcome to the Jungle.
Yeah.
So I really, really enjoyed Next Level. Like, I was like, I don't know if it can be as good as the first one. I had so much fun watching it. Still really like the first one a little bit better. And by little, I mean this little. They're both super enjoyable. And with how they ended it, I think if they want to make another one, they absolutely can. If they want to bring in Kirsten Dunst and she wants to be a part of it, it's totally going to work.
Yeah.
They did their homework. Mm-hmm. The roadmap is laid out for really, if you want to do all of that in the next one, you can.
Yeah,
absolutely. And I think the audience would be down for it.
Yeah, certainly would be down for it. And the Jumanji audience is the faithful audience, and you've expanded it to include so many different generations of people who are into Jumanji. Kirsten Dunst being going into this thing would be fantastic. Mm-hmm. All right, our last question here comes from Nancy Mallory. It's a Twitter question. She asks, with Star Trek Picard premiering next month, what characters from the Next Generation or other Trek shows would you like to see make an appearance? What Star Trek character would you like to see have their own spinoff series? Wendy?
I mean, I've never really been into Star Trek as much. When it was shown to me when I was younger, it wasn't, you know, I didn't know English, so I had to read the Chinese subtitles.
Oh, wow.
And as a child, that read very, like, textbook boring to me. I was like, what is this? But I like, you know, the space exploration, stuff like that. And my favorite character is Spock.
Yeah.
It has to be Spock.
You want Spock to come back and do a cameo?
Yep.
Okay.
Just, I mean, it doesn't
Would it be Quinto Spock? Because Nimoy has passed on.
Well, no, obviously it can't be.
Right.
Or it could be maybe not specifically Zach. I mean, God, I did love his iteration so yes to that. And also, also yes to just like his people.
Yeah.
You know, like, I don't think we really see that too much, and there's a lot more to explore.
Yeah.
So, you know, given now we have Mandalorian.
Right.
And we're exploring that whole thing. Mm-hmm. Why not do a one-off for each of the characters? They all get a season or something like that.
Yeah. Like where they're the focus. So it would be Picard passing it on to Data, passing it on to Riker, passing
it on to Deanna Troi,
passing it on to Seven of Nine. All of those are possibilities. I'm sure the number one thing people want is Q. Q is the character from TNG that everybody wants to see. Mm-hmm. There have been rumors that it's certainly going to show up in the Picard series. Would Q have a spinoff series? Because apparently a lot of rumors are going around saying that the girl that Picard is trying to save is the daughter of Q.
Really?
So that would be a fascinating way to tie it into it.
Was a spinoff.
Yeah, she could be the spinoff into the next season and what have you. I think Riker's always been one of my favorites. Riker and Deanna Troi, that relationship with Worf, that would be interesting. I'd love to see Worf come back. We haven't seen any previews of Worf possibly coming back onto the TNG. Certainly we've seen Riker and we've seen Deanna Troi both on Twitter and social media talk about how they're coming back onto the Picard series. We recently lost Rene Auberjonois. He would be fun to have back on from DS9 as Odo. I mean, as I mentioned, Worf here. Geordi LaForge, are we going to get him? I don't know. Kate Mulgrew, is she going to come back? All these different characters that have slid through the Star Trek universe. And look, Colm Feore from DS9, he was on Star Trek Next Generation as well. Miles O'Brien, he's still working nowadays. Why wouldn't you swing him around and get back into this thing? The Borg have to make an appearance, though. That's the number one thing.
I was waiting for you to say.
Yeah, the Borg is the number one thing. The Q is cool, but the Borg is what I want to see in some way, shape, or form come back into this situation.
I mean, this universe it's kind of like Star Wars. It's so expansive. Mm. There's so many endless possibilities, but I'm kind of hoping that they kind of follow the roadmap that you kind of said, like Q's daughter, potentially.
Yeah.
Allegedly.
Yeah, right. Allegedly.
Allegedly. Rumor. We don't know. Allegedly, but a lot of people are saying that.
Yeah.
So I mean, Picard is, I think, very highly anticipated.
Yeah.
And I mean, I'm looking forward to it. And I'm like I was telling you, like, I'm not really as into Star Trek.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean like I don't like to like just jump in like, you know, feet first.
Right, right.
And go for it.
And I think that's what they're going to do with Picard. They're going to make it accessible for people who maybe didn't catch The Next Generation or all the seasons of Next Generation.
There's so much to go back.
There really is. And like, you could jump in because that back then.
It's daunting. It's like, which one do I start with?
Right. And back then we did 24 episode series every season. You know, not so much nowadays, but certainly that's a possibility here. So they want to make it as accessible as possible. I think combining all these characters from the different shows mm-hmm. is a brilliant move overall. I mean, Seven of Nine coming on to Next Generation is, or Picard essentially is brilliant. So there's so much to have fun with here. And Kate Mulgrew, obviously still working. She was on Orange is the New Black for quite some time. So why not have her swing through here as Captain Janeway?
I'll watch anything she's in.
Yeah, yeah, she's great. All right, well, that's our episode for Collider Mailbag for this lovely Saturday. Really appreciate you all taking the time to download this episode. And hey, I know some of you have been complaining that you don't have it on the podcast channel anymore. But if you have Bluetooth, you start it. Hook your phones up, do the Bluetooth, you're good to go. You're still essentially listening to it like a podcast in that way. So thanks to everybody who sent your questions in. Remember, as I said before at the top of the show, if you want to have your question possibly selected for an episode of Collider Mailbag, make sure you put that hashtag Collider Mailbag on your tweet or your Instagram post when we put those things up on social media. Or you can email us at mailbag@collider.com. That's mailbag@collider.com. I want to thank Wendy Lee for stopping by. Wendy, where can they find you and everything you're doing?
You can find me on Instagram and Twitter @WendyLeeZaney. You can find me on YouTube @TheMovieCouple.
Yeah, great stuff on The Movie Couple too. Building and building and building, and your reviews are so much fun to watch with you. It's a lot of fun and interesting, very interesting reviews, these two, and they banter and they bicker,
but at the end,
yeah, they do a great back and forth, which is what you want to see. And we had an earlier question about YouTube. Give her a shot. Go and listen to her movie reviews if you're looking for a good movie review there, George Bates. So, all right. Thanks, everybody. Thanks to Adam and Smith in the booth for switching for us. And we will see you tomorrow with another brand new episode of Collider Mailbag with Dorian Parks, who sat in for me for a couple of weeks. He's coming back on the show to be my guest. And just in case you don't download tomorrow's episode, just want to tell you all, please have a safe and happy new year. Take care of yourself. Enjoy yourself. Spend time with friends or family. Or if this is a tough time for you, maybe take a little bit of time to yourself, a little reflection, take a hike, take a walk, listen to some music, or watch some of our Collider content. Make you laugh, make you feel good if you're in a tough spot, and carry you in through to 2020. We all want to see you back here in 2020, not just for watching our content, but just to live your life and see what happens for you in 2020. You never know. All right, we'll talk to you next time on another episode of Collider Mailbag. Take care until then.